We ought to be happy when it talks about where this is. That's what you have to get. You have to get in the stage of your life where when you open up your Bible, you're not saying, oh Lord, what can I do today? Oh, I can't, oh my God, oh, I can't, oh my goodness, I can't swear no more. Oh my. You know, but that's how we look at it. It's like a drudge. It's like this drudgery. But it's also not prayer either. It's not simply reading something and saying, you know what, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to exaggerate how good I am. I'm going to extol the fact that I don't smoke cigarettes. Amen. I don't smoke black tobacco. I don't do all that. I'm a great man. We can get like that too. It's two extremes. You got the self-righteous extreme too. Amen. He says the light is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Underline that phrase. Because when you love the Lord, one of the things you love to do is to meditate on his word. I don't know about you, but there are times when the Lord and I are together in study, prayer, meditation, that you listen, the phone will ring, the TV can come on, the Celtics be playing the Golden State Warriors. All that can be going on. And it's just me and the Lord. I'm happy. I don't know about you. Maybe that's why some of y'all look so sad. You haven't spent time with the Lord.
Amen.
I'm happy. You know what I'm doing? I'm meditating. There are times when I'm taking a shower and I remember a verse and I just start saying that verse over and over again. You know why? Because it gives me strength. The Lord says, meet me at your effort. I'm going to read your word, God. And then I'm going to repeat it. For those who come Sunday evening, we have a Bible verse that we give every Sunday night. And we try to memorize that verse. Now, I don't want you to memorize that verse just for the sake of memorizing. I want you to memorize it because I want you to mutter it. That's what the word here means. It literally means to mutter. It means to talk to yourself. Some of y'all talk these up anyway. You might as well just put the word of God in there. Amen. Amen. As long as you don't answer, it's all right. But he says to meditate. It literally, it says meditate in. In. That's a submersion. Amen. You want to be in the word of God so deep, it should be all over you. Hallelujah. You want to have a better 2019? Get in the word of God and just let it marinate. Sit in the word of God. Don't try to read it. You know what I used to do? You know, they say confession is good for the soul, but it's bad for reputation. What I used to do when I was immature in the Lord, I didn't know where to start reading the Bible. You know what I do? I flip my Bible out like this. And the Lord said unto Moses, number all the firstborn and the males and the children of Israel from a month old and upward, and take the number of their names. Ooh, I got my word for the day. Ooh, that was tough. All right, let's go. But when you meditate, I want you to do this. This is a quick religious class. I want you to remember, interrogate the text. Interrogate the text. Write that down in the notes. Interrogate the text. Ask the text five things. Who, what, when, where. And then add the next one. How. Anytime you read the Bible, ask the text five questions. Who, what, and I guarantee you, if you keep doing that when you read the Bible, it'll begin to cause you to marinate on the word. Take that text, put it in front of you, and say, now we're going to talk text. Who are you talking to? Where is this happening? How did you do it? Why did you do it? Just ask yourself those basic questions. You don't have to be a scholar to do that. You don't know that I have to know Hebrew and Greek to do that. Just ask a question. Don't read, study. The Bible didn't say read to show yourself approved. Amen.
Amen.
We can all read, hopefully. Amen. He said study to show yourself approved. Word of God. You need not to be ashamed. Rightly dividing the word of truth. You have to put effort into God's word.
Amen.
You put effort in your job. Amen. You got a project due tomorrow. Guess what you'll be up to late tonight. I got this thing done. Oh, my goodness. I got to do what I can't see tonight. But when it comes to God's word, no, remember that. I'll catch you tomorrow. That ain't that important. I heard a sermon. It was decent. the Lord's day, we're going to live in half an hour. But that's what we live. You can't grow that way. You can't grow that way. And if you try, you're going to become weaker and weaker and weaker. Now you'll come, but you'll be a shell of the man God wants you to be, or a woman. Because you're not growing internally. You're just showing externally. Many of us have sitting in churches for 30 years and we're just a shell of a Christian.
Amen.
Just a shell. Just a shell. Bible goes on to say, well, he's going to, I don't like this kind of preaching. He says in verse 3, and, conjunction, and he shall be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of the water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. The Bible says, let me give you an analogy of what I'm talking about. When you delight, when you meditate, you're going to be like that tree, that big oak tree. Anybody seen an oak tree before? Now, you think an oak tree is strong, you ought to see one by a river. You know why? Because those roots go real deep. I've seen trees that have been diseased and they fall over. And it looks like half the tree is roots. See, what happens is, there are some things that God puts in us that can't be seen. See, we can see our coming to church, but we can't see our roots. Some of our roots are so shallow. That's why when the storms and the winds come, we get tired. You know why? Because we don't have deep roots. We got shallow roots. Well, God, I'm going to do is open. Let's turn over here and show you what the Bible says. Yeah, I got that, but I just don't understand. Well, you don't understand it better than I know. And it's not to be flippant or dismissive. It's just that God says he's given us everything for life and godliness. There's nothing that you will face in this life that God had to address already. I'm sick. They're going to throw me in jail. Don't worry about that. But in the electric chair, the Bible says, what can a man do? He said, he can kill the body, he can't touch the soul. So I have all the answers I need. I have all the answers I need. There was an old preacher once who came to attend me. There was a non-believer that said, you know, you Church of Christ preachers got a Bible, everything. He said, yeah, we do. He says, as he was preaching, a fly flew by. And the fly flew in the man's mouth. He said, aha! He said, what's the Bible for that? And he said, he was a stranger, and I told him. We got Bible for everything. So you want to have the Word of God in you. Amen. You want to have it in you. Why? Because you're going to need it. I guarantee you're going to need it one day. Listen. Preachers go through problems too. There's some times when my faith gets like this. I feel like I want to tightrope with faith. I'm walking, but there's some things that I'm shaking. The Lord said, that's okay, Brian. Trust me. Trust me. Have faith in me. And you know how much I know God loves me? And I told you this before. I'm what I would call a homiletical Baptist. Homiletical just means art of preaching. But a pantheist is a person that sees God in everything. He sees him in the pew. He sees him. So I see God in everything. And you know, it's funny. I was at Walmart. You know, I love Walmart. So I was at Walmart the other day. And the young lady said, come to aisle so-and-so, the blue aisle between Holmes's and this, that. She had a presentation where she had this new product that they were trying to see if they wanted to sell at Walmart. She had the memo, she had the tile. She said, I want you, she gave a mark to the young man. He said, I want you to mark that tile up. He said, what about you, sir? He said, I want you to take this carpet. She had a kind of swath of carpet. She said, that's got grape juice on it. He said, man, I want you to come here. I spray painted this piece of wood. And this product she used, it actually got all those surfaces clean. Ain't no people sitting there. She gathered, here about 30 people. Everybody was gathering around, it was amazing. I was amazed. I mean, there's some stuff in my house I need to get clean. I need to get that stuff. You know, I got Lysol, Pine Sol, Comet, I'm up in the bathroom, almost choking to death because I got the Comet on the, you know what I'm talking about? I'm sitting there cleaning the room, I'm up there trying to get the grout, whatever they call that stuff, everything out, I'm sitting there cleaning the toilet stool, holding it. I said, this woman probably can do all that. She finished, she said, now, ordinarily, this costs $29. She lost about $30. But she says, you know what I'm going to do? Guess what today? I'm going to give you this, plus I'm going to give you an extra bottle that's concentrated. This whole bottle will last you a year. She said, just 1 ounce of this 64 ounce. That's all you do is put one part, the product and the rest, water. It'll get out like same. Now, if you want to concentrate it, you put 8 ounces and then 24 ounces of water. So she was trying to show basically how you didn't have to use a lot. She said, so I'm going to give you this bottle and this bottle. Regular, this one's 29 by itself, but this is, so great deal. She said, but that's not enough. She said, I'm going to give you an extra bottle. So now you've got 2 years, plus whatever's in the middle bottle that she was using, you're going to have that too. $29. She said, who wants to get some? There was a man from the river to my left. He raised his hand. I raised my hand. I want to get left now. Amen. I got my bottle. The rest of the people just left. And I told him, I said to her, I said, you did a great job. I said, you did a wonderful job. I said, I should be a sales rep. And I know how hard it is to get people engaged. I said, because as a sales rep, you have to show people value. You have to show them that they need it. They may not even come to Walmart to get any cleaner. They may just come and get some bacon and some dog food. But you got to show them the value in the thing that you're trying to save. I'm going somewhere with this.
Amen.
Now, out of 30 people, I'm sure 30 people had dirty rooms. They had spills in their houses, right? I'm sure they had kings that they wrote on the walls, crayons, dirty carpets, whatever, because you could use this thing in a plethora of ways. But when they said $29, people left. But a lot of these people that left, their kids had on $200 tennis shoes. $1,000 worth of jewelry. And ribbon, y'all ladies help me out, how much does ribbon cost? But you get my point. They saw value in surface things, but they didn't see value in something that could clean. Jesus offers something very similar. But even in a crowd like this, I can't sell everybody. Somebody leave here and say, well, that sounds good. No, let me come back. Cost me too much. No, I can't give it back. I got something else I got to do first. And the sad fact is, you cannot take it back next week.
Amen.
You may plan to come back, but the Lord may take your life before then. Here's the part two of the story. I stood there so long, my bladder got full. And when I went to go pay for it, I went down to the main line, and it looked like they were giving away free cheese. I mean, they had a line from here to California. Amen. So something in my head said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to stand in this line. There's an electronics department in the back. So I rushed my car back there and I've been out in there and they had about 5-10 people in front of me. I said, oh. But you know what? It was shorter than the line in front.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'll be the Walmart. Amen.
Amen.
So I waited patiently. My line was getting full. I'm here already. So I get to the line, I pay for my product. And I look and there's a restroom sign in the back of the store. I said, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. I push my basket to the next. They had a blue sign that says, no merchandise in the restroom. And I I looked at my basket, I got my receipt, and I got all these products that I said, that's just, I push the basket in the bathroom. Amen. That's how I push the basket in the bathroom. You know why? Because I paid for something and it was too valuable for it to be stolen. Amen. Jesus Christ paid for y'all. And you're too valuable to let the devil steal you now. So brothers and sisters, I want to let you know the Bible says here, he said, if you want to be standing like an oak tree, he says that bringeth forth his fruit, watch this, in his season. And his leaf also shall not wither. Whatsoever he doeth, it shall prosper. That's a promise from God.
Amen.
God says, when you stand like that oak tree, guess what happens? No matter what season you're in your life, your leaf is always going to be green. Brother Clark, I'm in the autumn of my life. That matter, God says your leaf is still green.
Wow.
I don't care how old you are, 9 to 90, God is still blessing you. God is still giving you the strength to be. He says, in everything you do will prosper. You can't help but prosper. Now, I know we hear prosper, we get tight because we think of preachers that use that term all the time. It's something called prosperity preaching. Have I heard that before? Well, you know, just name it, claim it, and gladly grab it, you know what I'm talking about? That's not what the Lord's really talking about. He's saying you will prosper in everything spiritually. Now God will give you what you need. And look at it, God's so good, he'll also give you some of the things you want.
Amen.
Amen. Don't get greedy though. Amen. God says pray and ask God, and if it be his will, he'll give it to you. Sometimes God doesn't give us stuff because he knows his will is greater than ours. If he gives you that right now, you go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. You wouldn't know what to do with that lesson. You go spend that blessing on some lottery tickets, amen. You spend that blessing on a Maserati, you don't know how to drive a stick, amen. You spend that, you know, I see a lot of people get a lot of money, year later they're broke. So you have to know, God blesses according to how he sees you able to handle your blessing. Then the Bible goes on to say, in verse number 4, the Bible says, the ungodly are not so. He goes from ungodly to godly, and he goes back to ungodly. He says, the ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Now, when you think of wheat, I want you to understand, in Palestinian times, they would have a threshing floor. When they harvested the wheat, they would cut the wheat down, they would put it in bundles, they would bring it to a threshing floor. Think of it as somewhat of a press. And so they would have a mule, or they would have ox, or they would have a big wheel, and they would normally have these up on a hill. And the reason why is because the hills were where the wind currents would blow through. So they would have the wheat, and they would put the wheat on the floor, and then they would have an ox or whatever instrument they would use to walk on the wheat. And when they did that, the grain of wheat, the stalk of wheat, would separate. And so when it separated, the heavier wheat would stay on the ground. But the hull of the wheat, or the chaff, it would be almost like a shell. It would be pressed out. So you would have the wheat on the floor and the chaff, on the ground. And so what the laborer would do, he would come in, and once the animals went around, or the instrument went around a few times, he would take his fork, he would go into the wheat, and he would throw it up in the air, and the wheat would land, but the chaff would get blown away. He said, in essence, the evil person is the person that can't stand because you don't have any wheat. And what would happen is either the chaff would go away, or the chaff would be gathered and then burned. He says, then God will not suffer. But are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not do what? Stand in the judgment. Nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Brothers and sisters, God, people of God, I want you to understand, the Lord says when the last days come, all the pleasure that you've enjoyed as a sinner, all the things that you've accomplished as a sinner, I don't care if you've been a CEO of the company, you graduated summa cum laude, it doesn't matter what you did in your life. All that means nothing when you die. You know, Steve Jobs, I think that's how his name is pronounced, he's one of the richest men in the world. I remember seeing an interview with Steve Jobs, billionaire. He helped find Microsoft a long time ago, I believe, with Gates. And when he was in his infirm state, he could barely walk. One man old, I think he was in his maybe 50s, mid-50s, late-50s. Young man, young billionaire. But all the money he had meant nothing to him. I know people that have worked 50 years at one job. And you know, they give you a gold watch. And then you love your party to say goodbye. Then people get home and they start watching their favorite soaps and their favorite talk shows. And you know, they go, you know, where's my life? What did I do? What did I come? Yeah, I got pretty good savings. I got some 401k money. Investments I made wisely when I was younger. What is life? And our greatest example is King Solomon. If you read his three books, King Solomon's three books, primarily his book, Proverbs, you see him kind of more in his middle age. He's looking at stuff, he's looking at things differently. You know, you look at his last books, Ecclesiastes, and it's almost like he's depressed. He's saying, all is vanity. And he says, man, let me tell you, you know, you guys can think you're smooth. He said, man, I have 700 wives. Woo! Yeah. What'd you say about Peter? Oh, no. He said, I had a lot of wives. He says, if that's not bad enough, I have 300 concubines. You don't know what that is. Look it up. And he said, I got all these women. More than Will Chamberlain ever had. And I'm still depressed. Still depressed. He said, as far as money is concerned, he said, I was the richest man that ever lived. I had bonds and bonds. Money on top of money. Young Jeezy, you ain't got nothing on me. Young Yanni, young Dummy, whoever you rap, it doesn't matter. I had more money than any of y'all ever had. When I took my last breath, I said, all was vanity. And that's just your spirit. There's nothing in my life that I want more than Jesus. He says, when I think about the whole duty of man, not the part duty, the whole duty of man, he says, to serve God. That's what I'll do. I had to do it all over again. I just served God. Brothers and sisters, we come to the conclusion. The Bible goes on to say, in verse number 6, he says, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. The Lord, in other words, doesn't have to get a report about what's going on in your life. You know, this word knoweth, the original language has a very different aspect and skin. It suggests, if you just look at it on the surface, that the Lord is just finding out. And because it's in the imperfect. So it looks as if God is trying to say, there is something about your life that I don't know, so I got to watch. But really what the Lord is trying to show us here is he's saying that the Lord watches over the steps. In other words, your life then comes as a surprise to him. He sees your hardships. He sees your ups. He sees your downs. He's watching over you. But your steps are guided when you're in him. When you're doing your own thing, the Lord says, have fun. But when you're in Christ, when you're meditating, when you're delighting, when you're walking and not sitting and and standing. But what you're doing is you're giving God the opportunity to say, now, don't make that left right there. Keep going straight. Make that right. There you go. Because when I look in the rear view mirror of my life, one of the things I can see is that there were some situations in my life that if I had made a left turn instead of a right turn, I wouldn't be here today.
Amen.
And I'm not just talking about in the pulpit, I'm talking about in life. You know why? Because God watched over me when I was an idiot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did some crazy things. Yeah. Don't believe me when they talk to boys. Y'all did some crazy things too. God guided me through those foolish times. He says, he watches, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. But then he concludes, because there are two people, remember, there are two ways and two destinies. He says, there is another way. The other way is this. There is the way of the unrighteous man. The unrighteous man does what he wants to do, how he wants to do it, when he wants to do it, where he wants to do it. And some of us are that unrighteous man. We do, we go, we say, amen. Nobody tells me what to say, nobody tells me what to do. I'm going to do what I want to do until it's time for me not to do it. Say something if you want to. There's going to be a time when the Lord's going to pull your card too. Amen. I don't have time, church. Well, you got time to die. Guarantee that. God's not going to always be merciful to us. This is mercy right here. This is mercy. Let's take advantage of mercy right now. Praise the Lord. Let's give God what he deserves right now. This is grace and mercy. Because one day God is going to take both back. And you won't be able to stand because you don't have any weight. That word pictures a trial that you'll be in. And the righteous will be on one side, the unrighteous on the other. And when you come as an unrighteous man, you have nothing to show because God is looking at you. And God is, let me tell you, people say favor ain't fair. That's true, but God is always just. He's going to give you justice. All you're going to do is repay your life. Remember when you were in 2019, January 27th? Look what you're doing. That's you. But why? Well, what happened was, you know, that's you. And you had opportunity, you heard the preacher preach. As a matter of fact, he was preaching what I told him to preach. But you decided you didn't want to do it today. And today became next week became next month became next year became then. But then it was time for you to leave, brothers, sisters, friends, and business. If you're not a child of God, if you're not in the body of Christ, the Lord has something he wants to give you today. It's the best gift you can ever have. And that's the gift of salvation for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. He gives us a simple rubric. He gives us a simple pattern. And he says, you can obey it today. Live by faith. When you become a child of God, it doesn't end there. Just getting water baptized at the end of it. You got to walk by faith. Walk by faith means that I'm not going to walk simply because I see something going bad in my life. I want to not come to church. I'm not going to not sing. I'm not going to not pray. I'm not going to not study. God says, you keep walking. Keep walking.